Welcome to Harris Cherokee Center in Asheville, North Carolina. It is the opening game of the inaugural Asheville Championship as the Western Kentucky Hilltoppers are taking on the Minnesota Golden Gophers. Along with former Purdue All-American Robbie Hummel, I'm Mark Neely. Robbie, our privilege to call the first game of this championship, and it features four teams from the SEC, Big Ten, Ivy League, and Conference USA.
Well, Mark, these tournaments early in the season have become such opportunities to build your resume. When you look at Minnesota, you look at Western Kentucky. Minnesota now, a brand new head coach in Ben Johnson. Western Kentucky, Rick Stansberry, they've been trying to make the NCAA tournament the last 3 or 4 years. Actually have been beaten in their conference championship game the last 3 seasons. An opportunity to get all of that out of the way, get in our at-large bid, find some quality wins. We've got 4 really good teams here in Asheville.
And as you see later tonight, we have the Princeton-South Carolina game as well on ESPN News. So we're set to go from Asheville, Western Kentucky, wearing the red uniforms, Minnesota in the gold. Bo Borowski, Keith Kimball, Amy Bonner, our 3 officials. Ball in the air and we're underway, and it's the Gophers that will have the game's first possession. Peyton Willis, who is back with Minnesota for a second time as a transfer, knocks one down from 17 feet, and that gets the scoring going.
You know, Mark, I thought he was phenomenal against Kansas City, running the point, running the show, not turning the basketball over, and there you see just a simple pick and roll, getting to his spot and rising up.
Down low, an easy lay-in there for Jalen Butts.
One easy bucket to start there. You could see Luke Lowy just flying in there a little bit late, out of position, and so far for both teams, easy buckets to start the game.
Jumper knocked down by E.J. Elijah Stevens. So Minnesota's hit their first 2 shots of the night.
Well, Western Kentucky better fix their pick and roll coverage, because right now Minnesota is waltzing into wide open jump shots.
Butts trying to get it to the glass. He cannot. Both these teams come in at 1-0. Minnesota, a 15-point win over Kansas City on Tuesday night. And that same night, a closer win for Western Kentucky. And Minnesota is out with that 3-pointer to a 5-point lead.
Well, that was deep, too. Jameson Battle from well beyond that college 3-point line. And again, another open shot for Minnesota. The defense for Western Kentucky has not been good early.
McKnight back out for Josh Anderson. That is a deep three and short.
You just get the feeling, Mark, that Minnesota's gonna make Western Kentucky prove it from the perimeter. They're gonna really be in gaps. They're gonna take away the drive and make the Hilltoppers make perimeter jump shots.
Willis, a little bit strong. But for the first time, an empty possession for Minnesota, trying to driving lay-in, but that won't fall either for Western Kentucky's Jarius Hamilton. Willis stopped there by Butts. Catch and shoot, Battle. McKnight over the top for Butts, but that's batted away. Curry swatted it, but Hamilton keeps it alive for the Toppers. From the left elbow. Out there for Anderson.
I am so glad to be seeing Eric Curry back again for another season. He has been through so much, and for him to come back, had to actually prove himself over a 2-week period to Coach Ben Johnson that this was really what he wanted to do. But for him to be out here after all he's been through, he deserves this season.
And here's Curry with a shot, and right on cue knocks it down. Minnesota had hit their first 3 shots, missed the next 2, but back in the scoring column with that from Curry.
Boy, right now they are operating out of the pick and roll at a high level of efficiency, whether it's pick and pop or getting themselves jump shots. Right now, Minnesota is off to a great start, and they are locked in on both ends of the floor.
Lowy. And a foul underneath. We get our first whistle. First-year head coach Ben Johnson picks up a win in the opener against Kansas City. Guy, of course, is a Minneapolis native. Played high school ball at De La Salle High School. Also at Minnesota and was on Coach Pitino's staff for a while. And now he's the guy. Getting his chance. That's a three in and out.
James Battle is not going to be shy here. He is getting him up, and he is a good shooter. Put your hand down on him. He's going to cast it.
McKnight off the mark. Yeah, Battle attempted 9 threes in the opening win against Kansas City. Knocking down three, and the lane opens up for an easy lay-in for Peyton Willis. And a timeout called by Rick Stansbury in Western Kentucky. Minnesota out to a quick start. Have hit 5 of their first 9 from the field. North Carolina has their own tournament now. We are happy to bring you back to the Asheville Championship. The Harris Cherokee Center. It has been a good start for Bid Johnson's Minnesota Golden Gophers. Not a good start, Robbie, for Western Kentucky, especially defensively on those pick and roll opportunities for Minnesota.
The pick and roll coverage for Western Kentucky has been so poor. I mean, whether it's guys just driving to the rim, getting open jump shots, the weak side, it's been across the board. It's something that if they don't clean up, Minnesota's going to pick and roll to death.
McKnight able to kiss one off the glass. Much needed bucket for Western Kentucky. Take a look at the players that are on the floor, brought to you by Asheville, North Carolina. Willis, Stevens, Lowy, Battle, and Curry. Those were the starters as well. Curry trying to go up for a jam there. That's a long three. Willis in and out. Hamilton. Back rim miss. McKnight almost saved the possession, though, there for Western Kentucky.
You can see the quality of shot from Minnesota versus Western Kentucky right now is not even close. Western Kentucky is taking contested jumpers, and Minnesota, for the most part, they turn it over, has gotten whatever they wanted when they've been able to get a shot up.
Deep three there from Luke Frampton. It's not been a good shooting start for Western Kentucky. They are now 2 of 8 to start this game.
They're going to need Luke Frampton, a guy that last year shot 41% from the three-point line. Had a tough start against Alabama State, 0-7, but a guy that can really make shots and get hot.
Knocked into the backcourt, kept alive. Loy brings it back across for the Gophers. Tried to take it to the rim, lost the handle, and it's going to go out of bounds off Loy and the Gophers.
The effort there by Josh Anderson was outstanding. And the way he got after it through the passing lanes and then stayed in the play, the quick hands, knocks it off Luke Lowy.
McKnight. Frampton's going to put it on the floor, drive it to the rim, and lay it in for Luke Frampton.
Well, you know what? When the shots aren't going down, you play off the closeout. And Luke Frampton shows the basketball, puts it on the ground, and gets right to his right hand.
It's Western Kentucky back within 5. Lowy. Step back. That's put up off the front rim. Frampton. 3 on the way. Did not hit iron and goes out of bounds to Minnesota.
Well, Luke Frampton, we see him get downhill, and this is the bucket he made where he gets to his right hand. Shooters have short memory, but certainly a boost of confidence for him as he came back the next possession. And boy, he was getting them up.
Neither team off to a great start shooting the three. Western Kentucky's missed their first 3. That's a miss, so now Minnesota's 1 for 7 from beyond the arc.
They've had good looks, had a couple rim in and out. You're right, so far, cold shooting in Asheville.
Oh, Here's the drive that's put up and in for Jarius Hamilton. An and one opportunity for the senior transfer.
Jarius Hamilton has really scored the ball at a high level. Two exhibition games, averaging over 20 points a game, comes out first game against Alabama State and goes for 21, but right there just takes Jamison Battle right off the bounce in the pretty right-hand finish. Now an opportunity for a three-point play that he can't convert.
Get it down to three, now they pressure in the backcourt, and it pays off. The steal, McKnight. Hamilton in the lane, that's blocked by Peyton Willis. Sutherland, and in transition, knocked away by McKnight as we go from one into the other.
Now they weren't able to convert, but I like Western Kentucky speeding up this tempo, getting into some full court pressure. Now, Peyton Willis is not by any means a pure point guard. I thought he did a really nice job against Kansas City, but he's been a wing for most of his career. You think about when he played here initially, Marcus Carr handled the basketball almost exclusively. So you put some pressure on these guys, you start to try to speed this tempo up, make the game at a faster tempo, that's gonna really favor Western Kentucky.
Sherman Brashear has checked in, so has Noah Stansbury for Western Kentucky, the son of head coach Rick Stansbury, but a travel brings it over to Western Kentucky. You know, you mentioned Marcus Carr, which brings us to the point, Robbie, that he's one of seven, the top seven scorers last year for Minnesota, which Marcus Carr led all scorers at 19 a game. Top seven scorers for Minnesota, all transferred out.
And the only player you're going to see tonight that was on Minnesota's roster last year is Eric Curry. Isaiah Enid on the roster, but out for the year. It's just a total turnover for the Gophers.
Charlie Daniels able to swipe it away for the Gophers. Sutherland. And that is going to be an offensive foul on the fifth year transfer from New Hampshire and Sheridan College in Wyoming.
That's just knowing the scouting report. Sean Sutherland catches the basketball. He is putting his head down and he is getting to the rim.
That's two fouls on Sutherland now after that offensive foul. Both fouls against Minnesota coming in. Sutherland diving. Minnesota gets a possession after McKnight lost it and Stevens took it away. Step back. There is a three that comes down for Minnesota. Just our second made three in eight tries.
It's been a three-point barrage here for the Gophers, and with Jamison Battle, he's not going to stop. He can make shots, and that lefty, the step-back jumper was pure right there.
Well, I guess we should give Battle credit. He has hit the two made threes they've made. He has attempted three. Daniels trying to reach and get a hand on that, and that's going to go to Minnesota. We come to a timeout with just over 11 minutes to play in this first half, and Minnesota got off to the fast start. They had the six-point lead. Pam, thanks very much. We welcome. Minnesota off to a 6-for-14 shooting start, 43%. Western Kentucky 4-for-12 at 33%. Pam, thanks very much. We welcome those of you that have been watching women's basketball and that terrific matchup between Arizona and Louisville, won by 2 points by Arizona. We welcome you to the Harris Cherokee Center in Asheville, North Carolina. This is the opening game of the inaugural Asheville Championship. Working remotely along with former Purdue All-American Robbie Hummel, I am Mark Dealey. And Robbie, we are into game one, and we have teams representing the SEC, Big Ten, Ivy League, and Conference USA in this first ever Asheville Championship.
Well, isn't it amazing how these early season tournaments have become proving grounds to better your resume for the NCAA tournament? And here you have four different teams with four very different stories, but the goal is all the same for all four, and it's to stack quality wins. This gives you an opportunity to get two of those. And we've got four very good teams here in Asheville. They did such a good job with Maui last year. They're getting their own tournament now.
Yeah, that's really how things develop. Remember, due to COVID, the Maui Invitational was moved here to Asheville, and it went so well, folks said, hey, it's a great place, beautiful city, good facility. They need their own tournament, and now they have it, the Asheville Championship starting this year. Now, Minnesota and their head coach, Ben Johnson, this is his first season. 18th head coach in school history, hired in March. He came from Xavier. He was an assistant under Travis Steele. Prior to that, had been under Coach Richard Pitino with Minnesota. And you can go back to the 12-13 season when he was an assistant under Tim Miles at Nebraska. But Ben Johnson is a Minneapolis guy. Went to De La Salle High School. Won a couple of state championships there. Played at Minnesota. And now he has the opportunity to become their 18th head coach in school history.
Well, a guy that has such a great understanding for the program and is going to recruit the state of Minnesota hard. The Gophers have had their issues getting top talent out of Minneapolis. It's going to be hard because the blue bloods are coming for those elite prospects, but there's a lot of good talent in Minnesota, and Ben Johnson is ready to do that job.
Second opportunity, Lowy tip. Daniels had the second opportunity for the Gophers. It was a very poor start for Western Kentucky. For those of you just joining us, the pick and roll game was really working for the Gophers early. There's a jumper left side from long range.
It seemed like Western Kentucky was really sleepwalking through about the first 6 minutes of this game, and they've woken up. Speeding the tempo really got them going, and I look for them to really pressure and press this Gopher offense.
Battle trying to answer, it does so. Well, Minnesota as a team had not shot the three so far in this game very well, but Battle has. He is 3 of 4 from beyond the arc.
Western Kentucky going with a little bit of zone action right there. And boy, you better understand where Jamison Battle is, because he's putting it up. And right now, he's a hot player.
Anderson, 3 off the back rim. And right now, Western Kentucky really can't buy a bucket. Even though they have fought back from an early 9-point deficit, they were down 11-2 to begin the game. They've gotten it down to a one possession game, but now back to 2, down 6. Battle. The heat check, and Jamison Battle knocks down another 3. Already is fourth of this game.
I mean, he is on fire, and really the only question there is, if you're Josh Anderson, why aren't you up on him? I mean, I know he's deep, but he's proving that he can knock those down.
Battle had scored the last 9 points for Minnesota, and the heat check came up cold that time. McKnight trying to back down Lloyd, but back out for Noah Stansbury. Shot clock slips to 5. Stansbury gonna have to go somewhere with it. Some contact, no call. The shot clock expired, and it's Minnesota ball.
Luke Frampton right now saying, I thought this was just the NBA. I thought in college we were still getting that call.
Well, what a college hoops game we have for you. Coming up tonight, Colin Gillespie leads number 4 Villanova against Johnny Juzang, and number 2 UCLA. Our top 5 West Coast primetime matchup starts at 11:30 Eastern, 8:30 Pacific on ESPN2 and the app. One app, one tap. Gillespie back from that knee injury. UCLA, a Final Four run last year. If you're on the East Coast, stay up late, because it's going to be a great game, Robbie.
Yes, it will. UCLA is loaded. You had Miles Johnson, who's one of the really good centers in the Big Ten Conference last year, along to a team in UCLA that loses nobody from their Final Four roster. Villanova, Colin Gillespie making that surprise extra year for Villanova. Should be a fantastic game.
Here's Battle at the line. First free throw of the game for the Gophers. Jamison Battle committed to Minnesota in March of this year, a transfer from George Washington University. Robbie mentioned earlier he had a team-high 18 points in their win over Kansas City in their opener Tuesday night, a 15-point win for Minnesota, giving their head coach Ben Johnson his first win as a head coach.
Well, that's really what the surprise is here for Western Kentucky, because you saw on opening night, this dude can shoot and he can really score. And they just haven't had a sense of urgency in guarding him here tonight.
Floats it up. This is Jamarion Sharp at 7'5", can't finish it. And yes, he is the tallest player in Division I men's college basketball.
He makes that 10-foot basket look like a Nerf hoop. I mean, he is enormous.
Willis around it out. Sharp is 7'5". He's 225 pounds, probably. He's not exactly your typical 7-footer the way he plays the game offensively. Nice move. Hesitating. Hamilton able to spin on that pivot foot and lay it in. And now he's hobbling a little bit.
Western Kentucky's going to need him, because Jarius Hamilton has really been instant offense for them. Big Ten fans think of him as a spot-up shooter from Maryland that averaged 6.5 points a game, but he has been really scoring it.
Andrew Stevens. There's contact there with Josh Anderson. Just a bit over 7 minutes to play in this first half from Asheville, North Carolina. A 9-point lead for the Gophers. Welcome back to the Asheville Championship on ESPN, the inaugural Asheville Championship from beautiful Asheville, North Carolina. Just over 7 minutes to go first half. Minnesota has the 22-13 lead over Western Kentucky. This Hilltopper team won the regular season at Conference USA last year, barely missed out on the NCAA tournament. It was their 47-20 win season in their school's history, and lost a heartbreaker to North Texas in the conference tournament championship game in overtime. Lost three starters from a year ago. One of those is a guy who's in the NBA now with the Sixers, in Charles Bassey, but also lost Carson Williams and Tavion Hollingsworth, who's playing pro ball over in Europe. And on top of that, for Rick Stansbury's team, who's missing off this year's roster right now? Keith Williams and freshman Zion Harmon, who they hope to get at some point, but missing both those players for this particular tournament, Robbie.
Well, they're just so thin right now when you look at their roster. They played eight guys in the win against Alabama State. Keith Williams, a second team All-American Conference player, and especially the guard position where they're really thin. And then Zion Harmon, a top 50 recruit, they could use both those guys. If they can get those guys back, they can make another run in Conference USA and certainly be knocking on the door of that NCAA tournament again.
And Keith Williams, a transfer from Cincinnati. Western Kentucky's waiting on the NCAA for clarity on a timeline of when he could be eligible. And for Zion Harmon, a freshman out of Washington, D.C., out right now for personal reasons. And you got a Minnesota team, as we mentioned earlier, their top seven scores from last year, all transferred. Three, Lowy. Sutherland able to keep it alive, but Western Kentucky takes possession with Anderson. Hamilton was trying to feed the post, but Eric Curry said no, no.
But Western Kentucky's offense, you just have to think, they've got to use these stops to maybe push the tempo a little bit. When they've got into the half court, they have been really poor in terms of execution. I mean, that's just a lack of focus throwing that ball into the post.
That's the guy you have not wanted to leave open from beyond the arc. That is already five, maybe threes for Battle.
But you're leaving Luke Lowy, who has not shot the ball well today or even last season, and you're leaving the guy who's on fire here tonight. Which does not make sense.
Just lead has been 12 for Minnesota, now at 10. Peyton Willis, a good pass. Frampton goes to the left hand, pulls up from the free throw line, in and out.
But Minnesota has had multiple shots like that go in and out. This lead could be even more. It could be 15 or 20 even.
Hamilton three, good splash. He knocks down his first three, and now head coach Ben Johnson in Minnesota want to talk it over, and they use a timeout. Just over 5 minutes to go. 25-18. Gophers from Asheville.
Just think, he'll be driving for real soon. Every new Chevy Equinox comes standard with Chevy Safety Assist, including automatic emergency braking. Find new peace of mind. Find new roads. Chevrolet.
You made a great point, Robbie, just a moment ago. I think Western Kentucky fortunate right now to only be down 7 with 5 minutes to play in this first half.
Totally. And honestly, that was their best offensive possession of the night, where you get a dribble drive to the paint, the help defense comes over, you swing it to the corner, they make an extra pass, and now you get an open shot to go down. They finally generated a quality look. But for Rick Stansbury's ball club right now to look at that scoreboard and say, we're down 7, I mean, they have to feel really good after the way they've played, because they have struggled on both ends of the floor.
Trailed by as many as 12. In fact, that one came up. It butts right in the head. And he had a foul along the baseline. Well, coming up Saturday night, number one Gonzaga is going to host number 5 Texas. A monster early season game in Spokane. Our coverage begins at 10:30 Eastern, 7:30 Pacific on ESPN2 and the ESPN app. Got National Player of the Year candidate Drew Timmy, number one recruit in the nation, Chet Holmgren, that is, for the Zags. You mentioned earlier some of the hometown talent that gets out of Minnesota and Minneapolis. Holmgren is an example of that. A 7-footer, Minneapolis native, the number one overall recruit this past year. He's with Gonzaga.
The amount of elite players that have come out of Minneapolis, and this is by no means a slight to the Gophers, because you've got the Kentuckys, the Dukes, the Gonzagas, the North Carolinas. They're coming to recruit in the Twin Cities area. But man, it's been a hotbed for elite talent.
Well, suddenly go to the bench. He has 3 early fouls, and on the inbounds, they lost track of Frampton for the easy lay-in.
Luke Frampton just made a hard cut. A little bit of a misdirection action there on the under out of bounds, and found himself wide open.
7-0 run here for Western Kentucky. They have a bit of a foul issue as well with Hamilton and Anderson. They each have 2.
Boy, they don't have the depth to withstand that with the guys they've got out.
Will a scoop? Nope. Hilltopper ball trying to extend this 7-0 run in the last couple of minutes. Going to launch a 3. Short from Jarius Hamilton, out of bounds.
Western Kentucky offense has not come easy, but they find themselves just down 5 points here in the first half. Luke Frampton making himself available, and the Hilltoppers hanging around. Jamison Battle has had the hot hand tonight. 17 points on the game. He scored the last 14 Gopher points for Minnesota. He's 5 of 7 from behind the arc. The rest of the team ice cold at 0-for-8, but he has been the guy from behind the arc getting this Gopher offense going, and the sweet lefty stroke, it has been on display here tonight.
Yeah, homecoming for Battle this year, the Minneapolis area native, a couple of years at George Washington. See what he has done tonight compared to the rest of the Western Kentucky team. He's darn near outscored them by himself. We're talking with Ben Johnson yesterday about Battle. He said Battle's lost about 15 pounds, so he's trimmed up a little bit. Not that he was overweight, but he has really added to his fitness level.
Well, he looks like he's in great shape. I just can't believe he had 15 pounds to lose.
Yeah. Well, Ben Johnson also told us he's got the green light, and apparently he's going to, that green light's gotten even greener
for as hot as he has been. And rightfully so, because he has been unconscious here.
Well, not that time.
He got a good look. They ran a nice misdirection play right there. He came off that screen, and again, Western Kentucky just not having an awareness of where he's at on the floor.
Somebody lost a shoe.
Eric Curry did. He was playing defense. Yeah. One shoe.
You know, I'm trying to match up shoes, but when you have shoes that have that many colors,
tough.
It was kind of hard for me to find
an impossible task for you here.
And even those shoes don't match each other.
No, one's blue, one's green, and boy, he just runs right out of it. And it's like running on ice after that. Tried defending Jalen Butts in the post with your right foot almost taken out of the play.
So we saw him play without a shoe there, but the noticeable thing this year is that he's playing without the knee brace, Robbie, and it's something that he has worn because of the knee injuries throughout his career, and he has to feel much freer playing without a knee brace.
Well, to me, that just speaks of how confident he is in that knee. And as a player, that's the ultimate freedom to finally play and say, you know what, I'm not afraid of getting hurt. I'm going to be able to go out here and play without this thing, and good for Eric Curry because he has been through so much.
Yeah, I'm sure he thought his playing career was over not long ago, and now the situation has evolved. Battle underneath, fouled by Frampton.
That was a great slip by Jamison Battle. We've talked about what a prolific night he's had shooting the ball from behind the arc, but there it's a simple screen and a slip to the rim. You recognize the switch as the defense, and he takes it right to the basket, gets himself a trip to the foul line.
Couple of great Big Ten games kick off college football Saturday on ABC. Jim Harbaugh, number 6 Michigan in Happy Valley, taking on Penn State at noon Eastern. And then Heisman hopeful quarterback C.J. Stroud, number 4 Ohio State, host upset-minded Purdue at the Shoe. Former Boulder Maker Robbie Hummel got a shot in Happy Valley.
It's going to be interesting. I almost at feel like we've used up all of our good karma here. Yeah. we beat Michigan State. Went into Ohio State's a different animal. We'll see.
Playing at the Shoe. The Horseshoe. Could be a fun Saturday. Hamilton spinning. Goes to that left hand. Too strong.
Boy, great defense. Jamison Battle is having a great all-around game right now. Really defending Jarius Hamilton.
E.J. Stevens. Transferred from Lafayette to the Patriot League.
That was disadvantaged basketball, and credit Peyton Willis for looking up the floor.
Anderson batted around for a moment. Butts had it. It rolls out of bounds off Western Kentucky.
E.J. Stevens had run to the right corner, and Peyton Willis did a great job of just keeping his head up, bringing that basketball down the floor.
So under 2 minutes to play here in the half. All the way for Western Kentucky, Josh Anderson, who's their top returning scorer from last year. Scoreless so far tonight, 0-4 from the field. Two of those shots missed threes. Willis got it. That time they were guarding battle, and that left Willis open.
Yeah, but if you're going to post trap, you better be ready to rotate. We know Peyton Willis can shoot the basketball. 40% from three last season at College of Charleston. And well, you post trap, and there's just nobody home.
Back to a double-digit lead for Minnesota. Run up by Willis.
Wow.
Battle short.
Wow is right. That was a heat check of all heat checks.
Kept alive by Butts for Western Kentucky. Launched by Brashear. Two opportunities there for the Hilltoppers. No points inside the last minute of the first half in Asheville. Minnesota's going on a 7-0 run here. Go ahead. Shot clock's down to three. Willis pull up, floats it up. Now Western Kentucky gets possession. Brashear takes it away, and they can hold it for the final shot.
I just don't really like that possession for Minnesota. A lot of dribbling, a lot of standing around.
McKnight hits it. But time for Minnesota to get the final shot. Trying to feed and lead Stevens. Wow! They left him too much time. And Elijah Stevens finishes the half for Minnesota with a corner three.
It seemed like Dayvion McKnight had realized as he was pushing that tempo and then pulled it out. I guess he didn't, because I don't know why he wouldn't hold for the last shot. Minnesota wisely pushes the ball up the floor. About E.J. Stevens just running this ball down and drilling a three at the half.
And a 10-2 run for Minnesota to finish off the half. They have their largest lead of the half at a dozen. Halftime in Asheville. Minnesota never trailed in the first half. They lead it by a dozen as we get ready to start half number two. But for Minnesota, their leading scorer in their opening win against Kansas City was Jamison Battle with 18. He equaled that in the first half tonight, Robbie, with 18 in half number one.
Well, he has it going. And you could see he had that look in his eye. At one point, he had scored 15 straight Minnesota Gopher points. 18 points, 5 of 9 from three. He's also got 6 rebounds. He's played good defense on Jarius Hamilton. Jamison Battle has been fantastic here early in Asheville.
A tremendous first half, 18 points, 5 of 9 three-point shooting. Take a look at our first half stats brought to you by Wicked Weed. And Minnesota got out of the gates quickly, an 11-2 run, ended the half on a 10-2 run. And I would expect, Robbie, at some point the conversation in the Western Kentucky locker room at the half focused on number 10 and gold, because they need to do something about that in the second half.
It's about having a sense of urgency and understanding that, hey, right now, Jamison Battle, he's hooping. We got to get a hand up when he's got the basketball. But also, you look at the way they played. They got off to such a bad start defensively. The pick and roll was really a problem for them. And then you look at the box score. Josh Anderson, 0 points, 0 of 5. You know, he's a huge part of their team and what they do. They've got to get him involved. I'm not sure that I would say that anybody played well for Western Kentucky in that first half.
So maybe in some ways, they're happy to only be down 12.
Right, no, I totally agree with you.
It's a little issue with the shot clock. That's why the teams have not yet lined out on the floor to get us going here in the second half. This is the opening game of the inaugural Asheville Championship. Later tonight on ESPN News, Robbie and I have the call for Princeton against South Carolina. Again, that's ESPN News around 9:30 Eastern tonight. Winners of these two games tonight, we're playing the championship game on Sunday on ESPN2. We also have a third place game as well. So Asheville, North Carolina, which hosted the Maui Invitational last year, it went so well, they now have their own tournament, and it seems to be a great place for it, Rob. Well, they're going to put the teams back in the huddle until we can get the equipment with the shot clock figured out. So there's a look again later tonight, Princeton against South Carolina. Looking forward to that game because you got a Princeton team, Robbie, that didn't play at all last year. The Ivy League canceled their season due to COVID. And South Carolina may have been the most impacted team in the SEC by COVID themselves, Frank Martin and the Gamecocks.
I just thought it was so fascinating talking to Frank Martin about the scout for Princeton. Because you're looking at guys that you've either never seen play before or you saw them in their first game where they played Rutgers Camden, who's a Division III school, and won by almost 60 points. So you can't really use that tape for much. And you mentioned how they just didn't play last year. So I think one of the maybe hardest scouts you're ever going to have if you're Frank Martin. And then for South Carolina, you know, Coach Martin really talked about just how they had to refine kind of their identity. And last year they lost a bit of that. You mentioned the COVID, and that is such a wild card for how it impacted teams and how much you had to shut down. And you're right, they got absolutely hammered by it. But you got the sense that he feels really good about where they're at and where their culture is back to being at.
Saw the shot clock atop one of the hoops. Not working right now, so they may be having to work out an alternate arrangement here. All right, team's on the floor. Looks like we're ready to start the second half. 12-point lead for the Minnesota Golden Gophers. Again, are wearing the gold. Western Kentucky in the red. So the shot clocks are off. So they're going to keep it apparently at the table. At the scorer's table. Bo Borowski is explaining to the crew there what they have to do from a standpoint of notifying the players as
facility are not working. The game. Countdown will be audible at 30, 20, 10, and there counting down from five.
So we have that to look forward in the second half, Bobby.
I cannot wait.
Western Kentucky ball to begin the second half. And an offensive foul against Western Kentucky, and not the way they wanted to start. As Hamilton.
They were trying to run Luke Frampton off multiple screens, and Jarius Hamilton must have been given the directive, you better get somebody, and he might have taken that a little bit too much to heart. He was really moving in that screen.
Third foul, by the way, on Hamilton, so he's the first player on either side to three. Willis, who had a pretty nice first half of his own, gives it up to Battle. Is he continuing where he left off? Get it out. It's going to roll out of bounds off Western Kentucky.
You see two Western Kentucky players going up for that rebound, and it's against Eric Curry. And that's kind of the way this game has gone. Every break has seemed to go to Minnesota. Eric Curry doing a nice job of getting on the glass and out-hustling two Western Kentucky defenders.
Battle on the inbounds, catch and shoot. Good pass ahead, three, Frampton, no. Able to keep it alive. Butts, another chance for Frampton. That's short. This time, McKnight. Yes.
Multiple opportunities there. I didn't like Luke Frampton's first shot. The second one is a great look for him. Doesn't go. How about Dayvion McKnight? Just the hustle, going and making a play and getting to the rim.
Curry over Butts. And there's Eric Curry with the left hand.
Well, you love to see it. A guy that totally deserves any success he has this year. Making a nice jump hook right there over the top of Jalen Butts.
Butts, now Curry on defense. Butts tried to answer with a bucket of his own, and then McKnight is fouled by Willis, going up with the rebound.
You just get the feel right now, Mark. The best offense for Western Kentucky is just throwing it up there on the rim and letting some of their athletes go and get it. They have not generated good looks from the floor tonight. But right now, they've got some real athletes that can go and get it. Minnesota's going to have to really block out.
Free throw knocked down by McKnight. Just three free throws in the first half for Western Kentucky. Well, Minnesota shot four. And when you look at Rick Stansbury teams, Minnesota playing Minnesota tonight, but at Mississippi State and Western Kentucky, his teams normally get to the line. And I asked him about that, and he said, yeah, we want to play that way. We just don't know how we're going to get there yet this season.
They did it against Alabama State. They shot 30, but they only made 17. You're right. It's going to have to manufacture a way there. But when they do get there, they've got to make them, too.
Second bucket for Eric Curry. Frampton, man, a lot of in and outs. Really on
tight rims here. This is a player's nightmare. I mean, this is like both teams have been searching.
Sixth season for Rick Stansbury as a head coach, Western Kentucky. Luke Lowy.
Well, the bench loved it. Luke Lowy, there's that advanced pass and just put that defender in the mix. Nice little step back pull up.
First bucket of the night for Loy, the transfer from William and Mary, and an answer. Josh Anderson, his first bucket of the night. He had missed his first five from the field.
They're going to make a comeback here in this game. He's going to be a huge part of it. He's too good a player to be off for too long. And right there, just stepped into it, shot it with some confidence, and drilled the corner three.
A Curry screen, pick and roll. Underneath, laid in. That pick and roll was the nemesis for Western Kentucky to start this game. They go back to it there.
They have really struggled. Right there, you see multiple defenders flooding the ball, and Eric Curry doing a nice job of distributing to the cutting Luke Lowy.
All alone for the stuff, Jalen Butts.
After this game, we might need to have a pick and roll defense seminar because there's some real struggles on both sides right now at checking that action.
Somebody call Carl Malone and John Stockton. They can make a little money after the game.
Those guys might have a million points in this game.
11-point lead for the Gophers. Here's the drive, and the lane opens up. It's flushed by Peyton Willis.
Another ball screen and another wide open shot. That time, the seas parted.
McKnight dribbles into a crowd. Hamilton, left elbow, stumbling around, falls down, and now he's slow getting up. He's acting like he's hurt. Pass, Butts going after it. It's going to be tied up. Possession arrow will give it to Minnesota, but Hamilton, see about him. He was acting like he was hobbling a bit.
Peyton Willis get it downhill in the ball screen action. There's nobody home, and he is cleared for takeoff. Peyton Willis going upstairs.
This is Peyton Willis, and this is my hoops history. I picked Minnesota because of Gopher Nation and Twin Cities and the opportunity to play for Coach Johnson. This year I intend to compete for a Big Ten championship and the NCAA tournament bid. My best move is between the legs, hesitation. Who am I? I am Peyton Willis.
Great material there, but what Peyton really should have said the first time is when I picked Minnesota a second time, the reason was this, because he's actually transferred to Minnesota two different times, and now he's back with Minnesota.
I love that Coach Ben Johnson said, I recruited this guy four times between high school and college, and I mean, he's gotten to know him quite well.
He played at Vanderbilt his first 2 years, then to Minnesota, then to College of Charleston, now back to Minnesota. This is Anderson. Foul getting to the rim, and Western Kentucky starting to get some more production from Josh Anderson, which they desperately need here in the second half.
Well, a really nice play by Josh Anderson. How about the hustle by Luke Lowy? That would have been an and one. I mean, he was going to go up there and lay that right off the glass, and Lowy flew in, saved a bucket, going to make him earn at the line.
Hey, don't forget later tonight, great hoops. Colin Gillespie, number 4 Villanova. Johnny Juzang, number 2 UCLA. Top 5 West Coast primetime matchup, 11:30 Eastern, 8:30 Pacific on ESPN2 and the app. We got another game here later tonight, Princeton, South Carolina. And then I got a feeling we'll be staying up for that one as well and watching it, UCLA.
We don't get too many matchups like that.
No,
at 11:30 awesome. Eastern time. That's gonna be a late night here.
Yeah. Oh, it's great to have hoops back.
No doubt.
Working remotely along with former Purdue All-American Robbie Humble. I'm Mark Dealey. Great to have you with us for this opening game of the inaugural Asheville Championship. Asheville, North Carolina. They played the Maui Invitational on this floor last year. Texas won that. And people thought, hey, Asheville, what a great place. They need their own tournament. They have it this year. In fact, former North Carolina head coach Roy Williams is the official ambassador of this tournament. Hopefully we'll have a chance to talk to him in the title game on Sunday. The three-point shot been effective for Minnesota tonight.
And over half their shots have been threes. They've been getting them up. This is, if you like analytics, this Minnesota team is playing right into your hands because they're 9 of 22 from three, and they've taken 39 field goals. This has been a barrage, and it's mostly been Peyton Willis and Jamison Battle. Once again, you're guarding these guys And you're Jarius Hamilton. You got your hands down in your pockets. Those shots are going up.
Lewis has hit two threes. Stevens has hit two. Battle is at five. 17-footer rattles around and out. Battle. Collision. I'm going to call that. Jarius Hamilton.
Oh, what a collision right here. I thought the foul might actually have been on Jalen Butts initially, because yeah, that would have been there, a charge on Jarius Hamilton.
Did charge it to Butts, so that was the foul. Open look. How about that? What a smile for Eric Curry.
Marion Sharp just backing off, and Eric Curry can make that shot. He can make threes, and he just dribbles right in there and drills a 19-footer.
And an answer with a three from the right side for Western Kentucky.
It just feels like there haven't been many easy makes on that end of the floor. It's like every shot is rattling in there.
Everything's been hard. On the other side, Minnesota's made their last seven from the field, and that streak ends there, but they get the offensive rebound from Luke Lowe.
Ben Johnson raved about Luke Lowe's mindset, his demeanor, and right there, just outworking Dayvion McKnight, going and stealing a possession.
Willis, long two, good for Peyton Willis.
Once again, the ball screen so effective. Western Kentucky in drop coverage, and if you're not going to get back up underneath Peyton Willis, he's going to waltz into jumpers, and again, good from 15 feet.
There's a lob, and they use the height of the 7'5 Jamarion Sharp to flush it home. But the other way, in a crowd, Lowy fouled, and there are two players for Western Kentucky slow to get up, one of those being Sharp. It's McKnight who gets up. Actually, McKnight and Hamilton there defensively. Take another look.
Here's the ball screen, and Jamarion Sharp as a roller. You better be in early. James Battle, not the right place. And when you do that with a guy who's 7'5", you are asking to get put on a poster. You better meet him early up the lane.
The Hilltopper foul was on Jarius Hamilton, so that's his fourth. Two shots here for Luke Lowy. Guy who shot 86% from the line at William & Mary last year. Hit both free throws he made in the first game against Kansas City, but misses the first here. Sherman Brashear taking the spot of Hamilton in his four fouls.
I really think that Western Kentucky would have sped the tempo if they had a deeper bench. Because I think pressing and making Minnesota face pressure would be the answer with Peyton Willis playing the point. But you don't have the bodies, and you get in foul trouble like this, and you just can't do it.
Curry got a hand on that. And Sharp touched that last.
Eric Curry has been really effective on both ends of the floor. Testing shots, making jumpers. He's had a huge impact here tonight against Western Kentucky.
You talk about the lack of depth for the Hilltoppers, and we mentioned Keith Williams and Zion Harmon's situation. Cameron Justice, who played for them a couple of years ago, just a few days ago, got his eligibility from the NCAA. He's going to come back. He's actually getting married tomorrow. They thought he may play tonight, but the rehearsal dinner is tonight. And if you're the groom, you don't want to miss the rehearsal dinner. I think that's a pretty mandatory thing.
Have to be.
They hope to have him here on Sunday. They add a little more depth. Now here, that scrum is cleaned up. And a timeout taken. That one by Western Kentucky. So 12:41 to play second half. 53-39 Gophers. Welcome back to the Asheville Championship on ESPN. 53-39 Minnesota. It's go for ball. There was some confusion this scrum. And one of the points of emphasis is having obvious possession before you get a timeout in this situation. And I think Western Kentucky's got a legitimate argument here, Robbie, that this should have been their ball.
I totally do. I mean, this is a legitimate argument before this becomes a point of emphasis. You can see right there, no one ever has the basketball, and somehow Minnesota ends up with it. That's just a flat-out bad call.
It is Minnesota ball. Three launch left side. That was long from Willis. Crampton wanting to take it to the rim, and there's the big man to clean it up, Jamarion Sharp. For our officials there, Amy Bonner stopping play, I think, because of to make sure some of the floor was cleaned up there.
I like the aggressiveness right there by Luke Frampton. Instead of taking a contested three, you can see that Minnesota clearly respects his ability to shoot. You show the ball, you drive it, you put pressure on that Minnesota defense, and then Jamarion Sharp does what he does best at the rim and cleans it up.
Taken to the rim, Curry. Well, you got Sharp at 7'5". Curry, who's not a small man at 6'9".
Compared to him, he is. I mean, everybody compared to him is.
By Sunday, we got to figure out what size sneakers Sharp wears, because they are large. So there's the tallest players in Division One. Early Riley Sorn, also 7'5". You got Zach Eddy from Purdue, who's a really low paint, back to the basket player. That's not Jamarion Sharp.
No, he's a runner and a jumper, protects the rim, dives in pick and roll. You're not going to throw him the ball and ask him to get you a bucket with his back to the basket. That's just not his game.
Well,
rightfully so.
Right. And the push called there on Minnesota. Take another look at the big 7'5 guy getting it.
Luke Frampton driving the basketball. Jamarion Sharp at 7'5. The Nerf hoop out there.
In the buildings, and that's great for this 2021-2022 season. Game two of the year for these teams, and right now Minnesota with a 13-point lead as Ben Johnson's team has hit 8 of their last 10 from the field. This is the first ever game in the Asheville Championship. Princeton against South Carolina. We'll have that for you later tonight on ESPN News. Under the break, McKnight at the line and sinks the first free throw. Still plenty of time for Western Kentucky here, Robbie, in a game where they quite frankly haven't played all that well. A couple of free throws there.
You're right. There's plenty of time, and their defense can get some stops and maybe get out in transition, find some easy buckets. They're right there. And you feel like with the crowd, and just saw the video about fans being back, the crowd is going to favor Western Kentucky here. The much larger contingency. If they can make some shots here, get this crowd into it.
Daniels had it knocked away. It's going to stay with Minnesota. Well, I started looking for the shot clock, and then I remembered they're not working in this half, so we're going to need the audio cue from the PA announcer. There's 4 seconds on the shot clock.
All right.
You know what I mean. And that's tipped into the backcourt.
Oh, goodness.
And wow. That is one. There was two on the shot clock. Minnesota's in their backcourt is about as deep as they can get, and McKnight commits a foul to bail them out.
You could hear the PA guy counting it down, and they were at two. Really, Peyton Willis did a nice job of selling that. But still, you run into him, and it's a surefire shot clock violation.
Been that kind of night for the Hilltoppers to this point.
No doubt.
11 minutes to play. Oh, he gets it back from Willis. Willis fouled as he was about to split a couple of defenders.
He did a nice job there of recognizing the 1-3-1 and seeing they didn't have much going and just putting his head down and making a play. You see that you've got a 7-5 center right in front of you, put pressure on him, drive it, and earn yourself a trip to the foul line.
17 foul against the Hilltoppers, so a 1-1 here for Peyton Willis, who's at the line for the first time tonight. He's a 77% shooter from the line last year at College of Charleston. He hits the front end. By the way, Sharp picked up the foul for Western Kentucky. Peyton Willis, Fayetteville, Arkansas native. Second different stint now with Minnesota, going for his graduate degree after getting his business degree in Minnesota. I assume the folks in the admissions office, all the transferring classes back and forth from all the schools that Peyton has attended to.
You better pick your schools right there. Some of those credits don't always transfer.
That's right. Offensive rebound for Brashear. He picks up the foul.
Again, a really bad foul. You're just going to walk 94 feet and shoot a 1-1.
This time it's Elijah Stevens. Shoot the 1-1. First trip to the line for him tonight. After he hit 2 of 4 from the stripe against Kansas City. Rick Stansbury's team just trying to put a couple of sequences together here, Robbie, yeah, where everything has a little bit of flow. We haven't seen that tonight.
It's been very choppy for Western Kentucky. I would say this has been the cleanest game we've ever seen here in college basketball, but they have really struggled to find positive plays back to back.
Well, the interesting part is Lloyd creates a steal. Battle, who has not attempted a shot in the second half, after a monster 18-point first half, gave it up. That's going to go on Luke Frampton of Western Kentucky.
He commits that foul, and you've got your 7-5 center running from behind you. Just wall up. That thing's going to get blocked into the crowd. Western Kentucky just has not played a very intelligent game here tonight. It's been a struggle in all facets, but they have not done themselves any favors.
It was a team that made it to the last three Conference USA tournament title games. Had North Texas on the ropes in the title game last year. We're just moments away from winning and going to the NCAA tournament. The game went to overtime, won by North Texas. Free throws by Battle, his first points of the second half, as he is up to 20. Frampton, blowing in his face. Anderson, jab step, and he gets past Battle, floats it up, off, tipped around, pulled away by Peyton Willis.
Great defensive possession. Both Luke Lowy and Jamison Battle just locking in and checking their man.
Charlie Daniels trying to kiss it in, but the 7-5 and the length of Sharp prevents that from getting to the rim. McKnight, they had a whole lot of those tonight. An easy lane to the basket.
An easy basket. What a nice surprise for a Western Kentucky offense that has struggled so mightily, but Dayvion McKnight putting the moves on him right there.
14 points for McKnight to lead Western Kentucky in scoring tonight. A pass from Stevens goes out of bounds. The lead is 14. Minnesota's largest lead has been 16, which we just had a short time ago. For that last bucket by McKnight. McKnight leans in. There was some contact from Willis.
That was really nice. The head fake right there. Dayvion McKnight showing the basketball, and Peyton Willis just flying by him. It's a very mature play. See Peyton Willis's leg getting caught up as McKnight stepped through.
This may be the best back-to-back possessions for Western Kentucky tonight, Rob.
This sequence for sure. Yeah. Bucket, stop, free throws. And again, they're down 13 points, possibly 12. I mean, they aren't far off, which it feels like it's 30. It really does.
You see Jarius Hamilton, number three, back in for Western Kentucky, playing with four fouls. So the lead is 12. 8.5. Play here in Asheville. From the corner, short on the three from Battle. Run out by Dayvion McKnight. He's got a look in his eyes with the Euro step. It won't fall, but he's going to go to the line again. And once again, stop by the Western Kentucky defense. And they get a pretty decent look, and now a trip to the line, Robbie.
He was not going to be denied. That was a one-on-three break, and you could see that Dayvion McKnight was going to do everything in his power to get to the basket. Luke Lowy trying to move his feet, commits the blocking foul, and this has been a really nice sequence here for Dayvion McKnight of understanding, if we're to come back, I'm going to have to put this thing in my own hands.
McKnight, who had 19 points in their win over Alabama State on Tuesday night, added 6 assists in that game, 5 boards, and barely came off the court on the floor, played 39 minutes. Well, Hilltopper fans starting to get back into this game. It's a 10-point contest with still over 8 minutes to go. Dayvion McKnight has scored the last 8 points in Western Kentucky to get it down to 10. 3 up, good, and Minnesota. Big 3 from Peyton Willis.
You find the middle of the zone, and credit Eric Curry for turning, facing, and finding Peyton Willis, who was wide open on the left side of the floor.
Third made 3 for Willis tonight. That's 10 made 3s for the Gophers, 10 to 25. That's well short.
Jarius Hamilton has really struggled, and his night has kind of been impacted by some foul trouble, but he has not been the guy that we saw through 2 exhibition games and then their opener against Alabama State.
And they had 21 points on Tuesday night. Timeout with 7:23 to go.
Every time Western Kentucky has felt like they're creeping back in, Minnesota has made plays, and Peyton Willis knocking down a big 3 from the left side.
With just under 7.5 minutes to play in our first game from Asheville, North Carolina, 13-point lead for Minnesota. Battle and Willis have obviously been very good for Minnesota tonight, Robbie, but the paint points have kept Western Kentucky kind of in this game.
I guess you have to say that they have. That and Dayvion McKnight here in the second half. The 3-point field goal disparity there looms so large on this game. Minnesota has just been bombs away from 3, and for Western Kentucky, unfortunately, they really have struggled making shots. Look at Luke Frampton, 0-for-7 against Alabama State, and 0-for-4 from 3 again tonight. He's 0-of-11 to start the year for a guy that shot over 40% from 3 last season.
Yeah, 41% from beyond the arc last year. You know, a guy that made 100 3-pointers in a season for Davidson. The only other guy that's done that at Davidson is Seth Curry. Hit it 3 times.
Rare.
Yeah, front in. Missed by Hamilton.
See if Minnesota can find the middle of this zone again. Eric Curry did a great job of relocating, making himself available, and then drilling Peyton Willis for an open shot.
Willis has 18 points, 11 here in the half. His career high is 22. It's came against Drexel last year when he was playing for College of Charleston. He turns it over here, and McKnight makes him pay with a chance for a three-point play.
There's the length of Jamarion Sharp impacting Minnesota. They were trying to go to the middle of this zone, and Jamarion Sharp gives it up. It ends up in the hands of you-know-who, Dayvion McKnight, who once again getting to the rim, points in the paint. You mentioned it. But again, this free throw can make it a 10-point game. Time is running out, but still, it just feels like it should be out of reach. And Western Kentucky is still very much in this game.
21 points for McKnight, which ties a career high for him, 15 here in the second half. We also saw Willis has four fouls. Put up.
Wow.
Sometimes you get the roll, and E.J. Stevens got it there.
There have not been many rolls tonight. That thing was about to rattle out as well. It's just been Minnesota is, they are just bombing it on three.
Wow, McKnight, a new career high. Lead is 11. Remember when Western Kentucky got it down to 10 a short time ago? Minnesota hit a three. Same thing just happened. That was almost stolen.
Pass.
Yes, it was. Lowy tipped around. It's out of bounds. Off Western Kentucky, they say. Well, Jim Harbaugh, number 6 Michigan in Happy Valley, take on Penn State, noon Eastern, 9 Pacific. Then Heisman hopeful quarterback C.J. Stroud, number 4 Ohio State, hosting upset-minded Purdue at the Shoe. All that tomorrow. Great day of football on ABC. Curry. Here's McKnight, who has scored the last 13 points of this game for Western Kentucky.
Got the whole side. He's going to go to the rim.
Leads in, short from 14. I think he thought he was going to get some contact there and did not.
He was trying to draw a foul. And once he picked his dribble up, you know what you're trying to do, but you better move it. Going to come back to you. He's been their whole offense almost here in the second half. I like that he's trying to make plays, but that was not a good decision.
5 minutes to go. 11-point game. It stays 11. Batted out, but out to Loy, and another opportunity for the Gophers.
I think Jameson Battle was having one of those games where you just wish that halftime didn't have to happen. You know, it's the ultimate fire extinguisher for some guys going to the locker room.
He has now made a field goal in the half. 2 points in the second half, both from the line. And now he's Stevens with a 3-point shot. Every time when you think Western Kentucky's got a little bit of life, Robbie, Minnesota hits
the ball just squirts out, and boy, E.J. Stevens, that took some guts right there. And that was one of those where Ben Johnson, you might be thinking, let's run some clock and get to the under four, and he had other ideas.
Minnesota foul is on Luke Lowy. Keith Kimball conferring with Amy Bonner whether this is two shots or one. It's going to be two shots. Okay, they did count the basket. McKnight has been a perfect 9 of 9 from the line tonight. ...26 points, a career high for Dayvion McKnight. We've been playing without a shot clock. Keeping that at the scorer's table, and that is stolen. Josh Anderson wants to take it in for the slam. He's known for those prolific stuffs. In fact, he had the SportsCenter top 10 play earlier in the week. Minnesota's coach, ESPN's exclusive presentation of College Hoops brought to you by Harris Cherokee Casinos. Put on your party hat. By Wicked Weed. Box out your thirst with a fresh, pernicious Wicked Weed Brewing. Drink different, play different. And by Asheville, North Carolina. Visit exploreasheville.com and plan your mountain getaway. Let's take a look at the Harris Cherokee Casino play of the game. We're not saying this game is over, but this is our play of the game, Robert.
How appropriate that it's a ball screen. We've seen a lot of that tonight. And not the best ball screen defense you're ever going to see, with Peyton Willis taking what the defense is giving him, going right down that lane and flushing it.
Western Kentucky's gotten this down to 9, 3:49 to play. The last time they were within 9 was with just 6 seconds left in the first half, when it was 32-23. Minnesota ball out of the timeout. Coach Rick Stansbury saying no fouls. Stevens rejected. Nice Sharp.
That's what he's going to bring to the table right there. EJ Stevens turning that ball screen down and getting to the middle. You think you've got an easy layup, and Jamarion Sharp is blocking that thing into the stands.
Second block of the game for Sharp. On the inbounds with 4 on the shot clock. Curry comes up short. Big possession for Western Kentucky. 3, Frampton. Still can't buy a 3, and it deflects off a couple of Western Kentucky hands to Peyton Willis.
We got a good look. That was a great pass up the floor. I believe it was Dayvion McKnight. He knew where his shooter was, and Luke Frampton off to an ice-cold start for his season.
0-for-5 tonight from beyond the arc. 0-for-12 to start the season. Willis, the 3. It's an air ball out of bounds. You know, you start playing, if you're a Western Kentucky fan, what if Frampton hits that 3 right there?
Suddenly, totally. The game pressure, the crowd.
McKnight has really been the answer for them in this second half. A spin move, a scoop. He's going to go to the line. No question, Dayvion McKnight has said, hey, if we're going to come back in this game, it's going to be on my shoulders.
Last 12 minutes of the game, he has been the best player on the court. That shifted from Jamison Battle over to Dayvion McKnight. He's been phenomenal here. Getting to the basket, getting in the paint at will.
26 points for McKnight. 20 here in the second half. And he's been perfect from the line. Now 11 of 11. Hilltoppers is a team 14 of 17 from the stripe tonight. He misses for the first time, almost came away with an offensive rebound. 8-point game. Under 2.5 to go. Stevens steps back. Gives it up to Willis with 10 to shoot. Stevens, long 2. Long rebound out to Frampton. He gives it to the right guy. That's McKnight. He wants to take it to the rim. Wow. What a half for Dayvion McKnight. Western Kentucky is within 6 with a minute 58 to go.
He has been a scoring machine. And I think you have to give a ton of credit to Jamarion Sharp for his defense in pick and roll here. He has changed the way with his length. Minnesota hasn't been able to get to real penetration. They haven't been able to hit the roller. And now all of a sudden, West Kentucky's getting stops, and Dayvion McKnight can get out in transition and make plays like this. I mean, this is really impressive what he's been able to do here in the second half.
McKnight, who's a sophomore, as a true freshman last year, averaged about 6 points a game, 24.5 minutes per game. a guy who was the 2020 Kentucky Mr. Basketball out of Collins High School in Shelbyville, Kentucky.
You knew he was going to have a bigger role this year. You lose Tavion Hollingsworth, who's had such a good career at Western Kentucky, and you knew he was going to be one of the guys that was going to step up to the plate and have to have a bigger role. And boy, has he done that and more tonight. Jarius Hamilton has been a little bit off, and he's been phenomenal.
Yeah, Robbie McKnight has scored 19 of their last 21 points. It was an Anderson dunk. Other than that, it's been all McKnight in that span.
If I'm Minnesota, I'm going away from Jamari and Sharp. You can run some pick and roll, but I'm not bringing him into the process because he is really guarded well.
Battle puts his shoulder down. Sharp tipped though by Curry, and a big hoop for Minnesota.
Sharp came over to block the shot, and that left Eric Curry all by his lonesome, and that was a really heads-up play by Curry to go right to the basket.
Lead back to 8 for the Gophers.
Wow, he is balling.
Absolutely on fire. Dayvion McKnight keeping the Hilltoppers in the game. It's a 5-point contest. Well, Coach Stansbury, he told me yesterday, he said, hey, watch Dayvion. He can drive it to the basket. I said, where is he at as far as being a leader? He said, he's kind of a quiet kid, but he's becoming more vocal. And I tell you what, his play is speaking for everybody on his team tonight because he's been dominating.
Well, last year, just 4 of 22 from 3. And you can see he is playing with so much confidence. The majority of his scoring tonight has been getting to the basket, getting to that painted area, and getting to the foul line. But, man, that rim must look like the ocean right now because he's got a 30-piece, and it's been an impressive deal here in the second half as he has heated up, and he is cooking now.
So with 71 seconds left, a reset. Western Kentucky has the possession arrow. No fouls to give. Both teams in the double bonus. Dayvion McKnight has scored 21 of the last 23 points for Western Kentucky. You see what he's done first half to second half. It's a career high for him. 32 points.
If I'm Minnesota here, I'm okay with getting into some ball screen action, even if Jamarion Sharp is going to be guarding the big. I'd say bring somebody else out there, but they're just going to switch it four ways with Jarius Hamilton at the four. But I think as long as you move the ball from side to side, you're okay. You've got to get the big fella moving. You can't just hold this ball for 20 seconds at the top of the key and go into a ball screen. It's too easy for him. This ball has got to swing from side to side and then get into your pick and roll action with Peyton Willis.
Minnesota has never trailed in this game. They've led by as many as 16. A minute to go. Battle, look to trap, knocked away, but there's Lowy. Willis kicks it out. Here's a three from Battle. McKnight has it. Here come the Toppers. McKnight runs into Lowy. Foul against Luke Lowy, stopping the clock with 36 seconds to go. Two shots coming for McKnight.
Minnesota got a good look. Jamison Battle got an open three, and they ran a good amount of clock, got a good shot, and the second that thing got in Dayvion McKnight's hands, you knew he was going to put pressure on that defense, and that's exactly what he did.
McKnight was 82% from the line last year. 6-9 from the line in their opening win against Alabama State. 12 of 13 tonight. Make it 13 of 14. And this is a one possession game with 36 seconds left.
And he's got over half their points. It's just been a dominant performance for Dayvion McKnight.
Timeout, Minnesota. They use their final timeout to 29.6 seconds left. Well, Ben Johnson's team appeared up rather comfortably most of this game. Every time you thought Western Kentucky was going to get close, Minnesota had an answer, but then on the other side, Dayvion McKnight became the answer for Western Kentucky, and it's come down to the end here.
Well, right here, you've got to prepare for two things. You've got to prepare for Western Kentucky to come out man-to-man and also the 1-3-1. If it's going to be the 1-3-1, you can set a high ball screen and let Peyton Willis play off that, or you try to get the ball in the middle with Eric Curry and let him facilitate it. If it's going to be man-to-man, I stand by what I said earlier. It is so much ball screen in today's game. You assume you're going to see it with Peyton Willis as the handler. I'm okay with that, but you can't just hold this thing and then play from there. You really got to move the defense from side to side. And as you see on the right side there, there's 23 seconds on the shot clock, so you do have to get a shot up. Shot clocks are out, so players have got to be really aware of what's going on right here.
So from a Western Kentucky perspective, are you convinced, Robbie, that they're just going to play this shot clock out? Or is there somebody that they may want to foul?
I would play it out, honestly. I think with 6 seconds to go and the way they've guarded and gotten stops over the last 4 or 5 minutes,
I
feel comfortable with doing that than just going and playing and let Dayvion McKnight make a play.
A 23 on the shot clock. Hilltoppers with a 13-2 run in just under the last 4 minutes. Have come from 16 down to 3 down with just under 30 seconds left in regulation.
Impressive
play, McKnight. Jump ball possession arrow belongs to Western Kentucky. Wow. McKnight, who's been the offensive answer, now makes a huge defensive play. A high-risk one, Robbie, but it pays off for the Hilltoppers.
Well, Luke Lowy puts Jamison Battle in the worst place on the floor possible, especially when you have the luxury of throwing it into the backcourt. That's a terrible decision.
Well, how do they handle this? 19 seconds left in counting. Down three. Oh, there's a three. Hamilton. And now a foul. I was just about to say, McKnight's got to take the shot, doesn't he?
I hate the shot. And how can you not? I mean, Jarius Hamilton has had a very good start to the year leading up to this game, but with the way he's played and the way that Dayvion McKnight has played, and especially in a situation where McKnight can go get a two. You don't have to take a three there. You got plenty of time.
Willis 1-2 from the line tonight, shooting two. Still a one possession game. Western Kentucky has the only timeout remaining. Two possession game. Hilltoppers have to hurry. They got it in the hands of the right guy. McKnight launches a three. Tip, good. 3 seconds left. The Hilltoppers use their final timeout. They have gotten it down to a two-point game with just 3 seconds remaining. Well, it's been a big mountain for Western Kentucky to try to climb here all night tonight, Robbie. They've never had the lead. Now they have to have a quick steal.
And it's a steal on the inbound pass, and then it's a foul. I mean, you just don't have time. We saw Minnesota working today at shoot-around on some of these situations. And they really went over late-game situations, getting the ball inbounds. We'll see what strategy they choose to go with, but they gave it multiple looks. You have to think they might run a guy down to the baseline and pass it out of bounds. That they could do the Hail Mary football deal we've seen. I mean, there's a lot of options here, but story is, if you're Minnesota, you got to get the ball into one of your better free throw shooters.
This game number two for Ben Johnson as the Minnesota head coach. Let's see how he wants to play it.
And here comes the football routes.
Here it is. You and I were talking about this earlier today. As far as out of bounds plays, You mentioned how Bill Carmody, who's been an influence for Ben Johnson in his career, is kind of master of these type of plays. Quick foul committed by Hamilton. Ticker so came off the clock. Stevens hobbling a bit.
Boy, he was.
And Hamilton has just fouled out. And Stevens walking gingerly up the floor. He is 2 of 2 from the line tonight. If he's able to hit both here, he can basically ice the game for the Golden Gophers. At the Backyard Brawl coming up next here on ESPNU in Pittsburgh and West Virginia. And Bob Huggins looking to tie Bob Knight with career win number 902. That's when we are finished in Asheville. Stevens hits a huge free throw for the Golden Gophers to make it a 3-point game, and he can ice it with this one here. No timeouts for Western Kentucky, so if he misses, they got to get it up the floor in a hurry or make a long heave. And that's it. Minnesota's going to survive this big comeback from Dayvion McKnight and Western Kentucky. They take the inaugural game here in this Asheville Championship, 73-69. And Minnesota wins it. For Robbie Hummel and our entire crew, I'm Mark Neely. Thanks for sharing this one with us. Let's get you to Morgantown, Pittsburgh, and West Virginia.